So today I'm going to talk about itch in dog and cats. So almost more than 70% of the cases we see, dermatological cases which come to our clinic, and most of the time they have a symptom of itching, which is recognized by most of the pet owners more frequently than any other sign. The primary sign is clinical sign is itching or pruritus, which is recognized by the pet owners more frequently. So what happens psychologically when the pet parent finds their pet is screeching or itching? So the first question comes to their mind: is this problem communicable or zoonotic? So I will not only talk about itch in dog and cats, but also I will talk about the zoonotic aspect of these diseases. Okay. So first we need to understand that what is itch. So itch or pruritus is an unpleasant sensation which provokes the desire to scratch, chew, bite, or lick. So this is just the sign or symptom which is caused by various kind of the diseases. Or there are various inciting factors which leads to itch or pruritus. The main challenge in understanding itch is we need to understand what, when, and how. So our today's goal in this webinar is when the itch is started, what are the inciting cause, and how can we neutralize it or treat it. So almost in all dermatological condition or diseases, in treating pruritus, there are so many pitfalls. The first pitfall is incomplete or improper history by the owner. Sometimes we forget to ask about the history, like what came first, itching or pruritus or lesions. And also we should ask about more history, like the dog is having a seasonal pruritus or non-seasonal pruritus, whether the dog is indoor or outdoor, or dog is having a habit of swimming. Okay, so all these questions we need to ask properly with the client. Sometimes we forget to ask these questions. And the second thing is the client compliance. Was the client able to give the previous treatment? So if the treatment given to treat the pruritus has failed, we need to rule out the client compliance. And we should know about whether the client was able to give the initial treatment on time or not. And the third pitfall is the drugs. There are so many drugs. For example, Apoquel, Cytopoint, allergen-specific immunotherapy, these all drugs are not available in most of the part of the world, especially in India. And number four pitfall is to understand the case presentation. Understanding case presentation is very essential to know about the diagnosis and further treatment plan. For example, if the lesions are present on the lumbosacral area, or the caudal part of the body. Okay, so the first thing we need to understand that it could be the dog is suffering from the flea bite allergy, because most of the flea bite allergy cases, the lesions, the distribution of the lesions we found were on the lumbosacral area and the caudal part of the thighs and at the base of the tail. Similarly, if the lesions are present on the on the ear margin and ventral chest or ventral abdomen, hock or elbow. So sarcoptis has to take first place in your list of differential. And when the scales are present on the dorsum, so the index of suspicion of dilutiella. And if the lesions are present on the perioral, periocular, groin, axilla and feet, it suggests atopy, atopic dermatitis as well as food allergy. So understanding case presentation is very important to know about the diagnosis of the disease, and we can ultimately plan for the treatment. So first of all, we need to recognize pruritus. So we can easily recognize pruritus on the basis of sign or symptoms. Like there are so many presentations, most of the dogs come with the presentation, maybe they come with the scratching, biting, chewing, dragging body parts, licking, rolling, rubbing against the object. Scooting means rubbing anal part against the floor or ground and shaking. So these all are signs of pruritus. We should know about these signs because there are some diseases which shows very mild pruritus. Probably that disease needs only histamines, antihistaminic drugs. Okay. And there are few diseases which causes moderate to severe pruritus and need to be given glucocorticoids and sometimes aggressive cyclosporin therapy. So this helps the clinician to further for the plan of treatment. Now here, you can see here, the dog chewing with the help of front teeth, and below here, the dog scratching with the hind feet, cat scratching with the hind feet, and this is rubbing the back of the dog back against the floor, and this is a scooting where the dog rubbing their anal part against the ground, and this is the head shaking because of the itching, and here, these cats are licking the various part of the body due to the pruritus or itching. Now comes the pruritus visual analog scale, PVAS. This is one of the most important tool to know the severity of the itching, to know about the what type of itching is present, how aggressive itching is there. It is mild, severe, or moderate. So we can easily differentiate by using this PVAS scale. The scale ranges from 0 to 1, where 0 being normal dog, itching is not a problem, okay? And the scale 10 means extreme itchy, continuous itchy. Even the dog does not stop itching irrespective of surrounding or command and need to be physically restrained from the itching. And if the owner come with a complaint that my dog is occasionally itching, so the scale ranges between 2 to 3. Okay, so we can easily recognize, so what is the level of pruritus according to this scale. Sometimes owner come with a complaint that my dog is itchy periodically throughout the day, and but not when eating, playing, exercising. Then the scale of level of scale is 6. And when the dog continuously itchy, non-stop itchy, then the scale ranges from 8 to 10. So it is very important scale to identify or to gauge the level of pruritus. In case of cat also, this scale is important, but not as significant as dog. But in case of the cat, we need to understand the difference between the grooming and over-grooming. Okay, because the cats does grooming regularly or normally. So how can we differentiate that cat is grooming or there is an over-grooming? Like, for example, in healthy cats or healthy cats, licking up to 1 hour a day, it's completely normal. There is no problem. But when a cat licks their body more than 1 hour, that means there is some abnormality. Maybe the cat is over-grooming, and it is maybe due to the ongoing stress. Maybe there is some introduction of new member to the home, or some psychological factors, or parasitic causes, allergic causes. So there are so many causes that cats started over-grooming. So we need to differentiate between that the grooming, what is grooming, and over-grooming according to this scale. And now comes the causes of pruritus in case of dogs. On the basis of severity, the causes of pruritus in case of dog is divided into two parts. Diseases which causes severe itch and the diseases which causes mild to moderate itch. So these four are the diseases like atopic dermatitis, food reactions, flea allergy, and scabies. It causes severe itch. Why I am putting here Demodex? Because Demodex is the disease which is not a very pruritic. It is a non-pruritic disease, but sometimes because of the secondary infections, it becomes pruritic and very pruritic. So variable kind of pruritus is present in demodicosis. It's not so pruritic, okay? And in case of the diseases which causes the moderate itch, it includes pyoderma, bacterial overgrowth, dry skin, and malassezia. So these are the big four reasons which causes severe itch, atopic dermatitis, food reactions, flea allergy, and scabies. And these are the secondary factors which causes the pruritus. And there are some other diseases also which causes pruritus. But in that diseases, pruritus is not an initial sign. But in these diseases, pruritus or itching is the initial sign and lesions comes after pruritus. Okay. And in case of the cats, the causes of pruritus is due to the parasites, allergy, and infectious. So these are the various parasites which causes pruritus in case of the cats. And there are infections like pyoderma, dermatophytes, and allergy also, which causes pruritus in case of the cats. And in cats particularly, we see common skin reaction pattern like papulocrustis, miliary dermatitis, eosinophilic granuloma complex. This miliary dermatitis looks like millet seeds on the lumbosacral area of the cats, particularly we see in case of the flea bite allergy. And second is the eosinophilic granuloma complex, which is the manifestation of three things like eosinophilic granuloma, indolent ulcer, and eosinophilic crack, which is mostly due to the allergic reactions. It could be because of the atopy, food reactions, and flea bite allergy in case of cats. And the third reaction pattern is the self-induced alopecia and hair loss. Mainly these reactions we see in case of a cat suffering from demodicosis, particularly Demodex gattii, and also in case of the psychogenic alopecia. Okay, and the fourth one is the head and neck pruritus. Head and neck pruritus reaction pattern we see mostly with the food reaction, adverse food reaction in case of the cat. And scaling. Scaling also we see sometimes there are so many reasons for scaling. It could be because of the Kylichiella, maybe because of the cutaneous lymphoma. So these all are reaction patterns we need to notice in case of the cats, what's going on. Because in cats, it's not easy to detect the diseases based on pruritus. Okay, so we need to see these lesions on in case of the cats. So whatever the case presentation is there, if the case presentation, whether it is a mild itch or moderate itch, we always consider itch as urgent. Okay, so we need to change the approach towards the pruritic dog. Okay, first day only, we need to give some corticosteroids or some injectable like antihistamines to stop the itch. Okay, then only we can go further, move further. Like if there is an ectoparasite, we need to rule out after stopping itching. We need to rule out the ectoparasite. So this is all this. This is the proper protocol. Okay, we can approach towards the pruritic dog. First one, stop the itch. Second, rule out the ectoparasites by doing the microscopic examination, skin scraping. Okay, third number, treat skin infection by doing cytology. If you find neutrophils or bacteria, whether you find the Malassezia, you can treat it according to your finding. And the fourth one is the conduct food trial. If you have already ruled out these ectoparasites or skin infection, the number four one, you need to do the diet elimination trial. Okay. And the last thing is to confirm atopic dermatitis. First, we need to rule out all other diseases. Then only we can confirm the atopic dermatitis finally. Okay. So this is the proper protocol to treat itch cases. So first we will discuss about the diseases which causes severe itch. Okay. Now comes first the atopic dermatitis. Atopic dermatitis, as we all know, is the diseases which causes severe itch. And how we can define this? It is a genetically predisposed inflammatory and pruritic allergic skin disease with characteristic clinical features associated with IgE antibodies against environmental allergens. Okay, so the dogma for many years was that there was a type 1 hypersensitivity which triggered the production of allergen-specific IgE antibodies. And re-exposure to these allergen releasing various cytokines, which causes inflammation or pruritus. But the current proposed pathogenesis is the major route of allergen exposure is percutaneous absorption with barrier dysfunction. once the allergen enters into the epidermis, it is presented to the naive T cells, draining lymph node. Okay, so these, there is a proliferation of the T helper 2 cells, and this this causes the production of the IgE antibodies and re-exposure to the re-exposure to the allergens, which causes the mast cell degranulation and basophil degranulation, which releases the cytokines or inflammatory cells, produces the inflammations and the pruritus. So all these pathogenesis of atopic dermatitis is quite complex. Okay, so now it comes to the conclusion that pathogenesis involves three things, like immune response, epidermal barrier dysfunctions, and the infection. All these three things are interrelated to cause the pathogenesis of atopic dermatitis. And there are main allergens are house dust mite, storage mites, pollen, mold, and dandruff. So typically, this atopic dermatitis we see between 6 months to 3 years of age, and there are particular breed which are predisposed to atopic dermatitis is Boxer, Sharp Eye, Dalmatian, English Bulldog, Yorkshire Terrier, Labrador, GSD, German Shepherd, Retrievers, and mainly in case of brachycephalic breeds also we see the atopic dermatitis cases. And mainly in India, we see in Labrador and in Golden Retriever, and also in case of the pug. Okay. And when we talk about seasonality, it's variable. But most of the signs, clinical signs, we see in a particular season in case of atopic dermatitis. So mostly we see the seasonal pruritus in atopic dermatitis. And when we talk about the lesions distribution, the lesions particularly found around the face, like periocular, perioral, concave aspect of the ear pinna, ventral abdomen, plexar aspect of elbow, carpal and tarsal joints, interdigital skin, and perianal area. So here you can see the distribution of the lesions. Here, perioocular, perioral, and the feet involved. And on ventral side, you can see in the axilla and the groin area and concave part of the ear and perioocular and even in the feet. But the main challenge is how to differentiate between the food allergy and atopic dermatitis. Because clinically, food allergy and atopic dermatitis are indistinguishable. Both look similar. So how can we differentiate? I will tell you. Okay. Like here you can see, this is the pit bull having erythematous lesions on the concave part of the ear. Okay. Here also you can see in the erythematous lesions in the interdigital space. And here, periocular, perioral area. And this is periocular area. And here you can see clearly there is a perioral lesions, erythematous lesions. And here you can see even the crust also. So this is all the sign of atopic dermatitis, or even you can say it's a food allergy. So how can we differentiate it? Okay, I will let you know later. So here also in this picture, you can see the erythematous lesions on the concave part of the ear, and here also, this is all the cases of atopic dermatitis. And atopic dermatitis, basically, they predispose to staphylococcal infection as well as the malassezia infection. These all two infections occur because of the secondary infections. Okay, sometimes concurrently we find the staphylococcus and the malassezia infection along with atopic dermatitis. In this case, like you can see, there are some staphylococcal infections also in the ear canal. And here also you can see, this is the erythematous lesions on the groin area and in the feet and perianal area. This is again the second case where you can see the axilla part, erythema is there. And in the groin area also, you can see the erythematous lesions. And here also. And this is the something different picture where you can see some difference from the previous picture. Like here, you can see the location is same, but there is a hyperpigmentation or darkening of the skin is there. So when we do the cytology, okay, in this hyperpigmented skin, we find lot of malassezia. So why it occur? So on the basis of when we ask thorough history with the client, then we come to the conclusion that it was the case of neglected atopic dermatitis, which was not treated timely. And the atopic dermatitis, because of the pruritus or inflammation, it become chronic, and there is the secondary hyperpigmentation or malassezia infection occur. So we need to always rule out what's going on, what are the underlying causes when we treat anything. Like when we do the cytology, we find malassezia, and we have done all the treatment for malassezia, but what happened? It relapsed again. Okay, so we need to come to the conclusion that what's going on. Like we need to find out the underlying cause, and only we can crack any case. So this is the case of malassezia along with atopic dermatitis. Okay, this is the presentation. And favorites criteria, I myself consider favorite criteria is one of the important tool to identify or diagnose the case atopic dermatitis. Okay, we can easily diagnose the case of atopy by following these favorites criteria. So what is favorites criteria? According to favorites criteria, the dog age at onset should be less than 3 years of age. Okay, like typically it starts between 6 months to 3 years. And he says mostly confined to indoor pets. And here pruritus at onset, it affects the front feet, affect ear pinna, non-affected ear margin. So here we can differentiate from the sarcoptes, because sarcoptes basically affects the ear margin and dorsolumbar area. It will not affect the dorsolumbar area, because in dorsolumbar area, what will affect? The flea allergy. Flea allergy hypersensitivity we see generally on the lumbosacral area. So, and the last point is glucocorticoid responsive therapy. So all these 8 factors, the sensitivity and specificity of atopic dermatitis or favorites criteria is 80%, then 5 out of 8 are fulfilled. Okay. So how we diagnose CAT? Basically, there is no diagnostic tool to detect atopic dermatitis. We need to diagnose atopic dermatitis on the basis of history, clinical sign or lesions distribution, and ruling out other pruritic diseases. Means it is a diagnosis of exclusion all other diseases which causes pruritus, like sarcoptes, flea allergy, bacterial folliculitis, malassezia, and food adverse food reactions. So sometimes we do allergy test in vivo, in vitro, but there is no use. It's a non-diagnostic. This only we do just for the identification of the allergen which involved in the process to produce a specific vaccine. Okay, which this we do when we have a confirmed case of atopic dermatitis according to the history or clinical sign. Then only it helps to produce the allergen or to know about the allergens, okay, in the process to produce a vaccine. So it is not a diagnostic test. Okay, remember this. So what are the differences between the serum allergy testing or intradermal allergy testing? Basically, serum allergy testing is an in vitro method, while intradermal is in vivo. And serum allergy is less sensitive to medication interference, while intradermal is sensitive. And serum allergy is very practical in most settings. Okay, and intradermal is non-practical. And serum allergy testing gives results, it will take long time, like 7 days time to get the results. While in case of the intradermal allergy testing, we get immediate results within 20 to 30 minutes. So when we talk about the therapy in canine atopic dermatitis.
Hatred Pharma introduces Azithromycin 300 tablets. Azithromycin 300 mg, the cure that embraces with care. Azithromycin tablets 300 mg, Azithro Hat 300. macrolide antibiotic systemic drug. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic against gram positive, gram negative and other organisms. Example: Mycoplasma pneumoniae and Borrelia burgdorferi. Antiprotozoal effect against Babesia species and Toxoplasma species. Dosage for dogs and cats: 5 to 10 mg per kg once daily for 3 to 7 days. Route: oral. Presentation: 1 into 6 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatred.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So there are so many things, or we need to pay attention for that, because the pathogenesis is complex. Pathogenesis, in the pathogenesis, three factors like immune response, epidermal barrier dysfunction, and the third is infection. So we need to clear all these factors to successfully treat the case. So for the multifaceted disease, that's why it's called multifaceted disease. For multifaceted disease, we require the multifaceted approach. Okay, so therapy is like, there are two types of therapy: foundation and supplementary therapy. Under foundation therapy, it includes ochlocetinib, loquivetmap, cyclosporine, glucocorticoids, and allergen specific immunotherapy. And supplementary therapy, in addition to foundation therapy, supplementary therapy also helpful in the management and stability of the case. It includes antihistamine, topical therapy, and essential fatty acids. So first we talk about ochlocetinib. Why I'm talking about ochlocetinib? Because we should understand, we need to know what are the advantages over cyclosporine, what are the disadvantages of ochlocetinib, so that we can understand what are the beneficial points to use ochlocetinib and what are the disadvantages of using ochlocetinib. Okay, but unfortunately it's not available. But whoever vets are using this ochlocetinib, they should know about it. Like this ochlocetinib, what is ochlocetinib? This is JAK inhibitor, Janus kinase inhibitor, and commonly known as Apoquel. Principally, it is antipruritic, immunosuppressive, and having some anti-inflammatory activity. And particularly, it is it acts against pruritus very fast. Okay, and this is how it works. Basically, it inhibits the formation of pruritogenic and pro-inflammatory cytokines. Okay, and the main disadvantage of this drug is we cannot use ochlocetinib below 12 months of age dog. So this is the first disadvantage of ochlocetinib. We cannot use under 12 months of age. And the second thing is, like what happened in atopy, actually, mechanism of pruritus induced by interleukin 31 in atopy. Here, T helper 2 cells, which are activated in case of atopic dermatitis, T helper 2 cell produces a pruritogenic and pro-inflammatory cytokines, including interleukin 31. This is the culprit. Interleukin 31 is the culprit which causes severe pruritus in case of atopic dermatitis. So this basically, this interleukin binds to the receptor on the membrane of neurons to activate the JAK pathway, which causes itching. So overall, what causes itching? This interleukin 31 causes itching in case of atopic dermatitis. So what this Apoquel, how it works? Like Apoquel binds with the JAK receptor to block the induction of pruritus. It blocks the JAK receptor. Okay, so it binds with the JAK receptor and it blocks the induction of pruritus. So we need to understand the mechanism of this Apoquel, how it acts. So what are the doses of Apoquel? So dose is 0.4, very less, 0.4 to 0.6 mg per kg orally, twice a day for 14 days, then once in a day. And is that it stops pruritus within 4 to 6 hours. without any disadvantage or without any harmful effects. Okay, like glucocorticoids. And it is 75% effective and it is well tolerated. Another side effect is that we cannot use ocular if there is ongoing infections or if there is any ectoparasitic infections or if the dog is having some neoplastic growth or tumor. Okay, so there should not be used ocular on those cases. Now comes the Loki Vet Map. Loki Vet Map, how it is very important to know because it's very specific drug or it's very like it is a canonized anti-canine interleukin 31 monoclonal antibody that has demonstrated efficacy in reducing pruritus associated with atopic dermatitis. Why it is good? Because it directly attacked the interleukin 31. Okay, so it is highly specific in its action to reduce the pruritus. And the advantage of this drug is, whatever the disadvantage of ocularsitinib, here the advantage of Loki Vet Map, it is, there is no risk of Loki Vet Map used in case of the infection, parasites, or in neoplasia. You can use it to stop pruritus. Okay, so Loki Vet Map is very useful drug. And it how it works, I have already explained that cytopoints, what it will do, it just act on circulating interleukin 31 and very fast onset to, of action. So the dose of this cytopoint is at the dose rate of 2 mg per kg once in a month. So it's very important. It is just once in a month we need to give subcutaneous. It reduces pruritus and the allergic reactions. So it is a miracle. It is very effective in reducing pruritus in 60% of the dog with allergic dermatitis. And the very fast onset of action takes 1 to 3 days. But the good thing is that only once you need to give the injection, then repeat it after a month. So the client compliance is good in case of the Loki Vet Map. So the cytopoints can be given to dogs of all age group, below 12 months of age dog also. And also we can give with the, any concomitant diseases and combination with any medication. It's very safe. There is no side effect and no side effects not reported so far. Okay, so we can use in young dogs less than 1 year of age. The main indication of the cytopoint is this. Now comes the cyclosporin. Cyclosporin is also a very wonderful drug. Okay, and this cyclosporin is basically secreted from Tolipocladium inflatum fungus, and it is very potent anti-inflammatory drug, or it can inhibit the activation of many cells involved in allergic reactions, that is those that initiate the immune reactions and the effector cells. Cyclosporin inhibits the synthesis of several interleukins, that is mainly it inhibits the interleukin 2. Like Apoquel or Cytopoin, they inhibit the interleukin 31. And here, cyclosporin inhibits the interleukin 2 and other cytokines. And it is given at the dose rate of 5 mg per kg orally, once in a day, 1 month, then reduces the dose or taper the dose, like 5 mg per kg every other day, every 48 hours, and 5 mg per kg every 72 hours. So we need to taper the dose like this. And the disadvantage of this drug is that it is slow acting. We see the effect after 10 to 14 days. We need to give continuity this drug and we will see the result after 14 days or 15 days. But the side effects are also very common. In case of cyclosporin, we see very commonly there is a vomiting, diarrhea, anorexia. And most of the time we see the gastrointestinal sign while giving cyclosporin. If the patient vomits, what we recommend then? We recommend a client, we say that just give the capsule with the food. Otherwise, cyclosporin should be given empty stomach or before 2 hours before meal or 3 hours after meal. But if the patient vomits, we advise client that you can give capsule along with the food. And if you are, and the other thing also we can do, just keep the capsule in the freezer, okay, and wait for some time and you can give it. And it reduces the chances of the gastrointestinal signs. And also in some cases, we can say that just wait for a few days. And in most of the cases, the vomiting disappears spontaneously. So this is the main disadvantage of cyclosporine, that it causes gastrointestinal signs, and the effect of cyclosporine is late and it delaying the effect. So it's all the disadvantages of cyclosporine. That's why we are still waiting for apoquel and cytopoint-like drug in India. So one more important thing in case of the cyclosporine, you need to pay attention at this point, like administration of cyclosporine and ketoconazole concurrently at 2.5 mg per kg each may be as effective as cyclosporine alone at 5 mg per kg for the treatment of canine atopic dermatitis. What I want to say that ketoconazole, when we add ketoconazole with the cyclosporine, it reduces the dose of cyclosporine just half. Why? Because it increases the bioavailability or absorption of cyclosporine in the bloodstream. So it is very helpful. It reduces the cost because cyclosporine is a very costly tablet. So when we add ketoconazole, it reduces the cost of cyclosporine, and also it reduces the side effects of cyclosporine when we reduce the dose of cyclosporine. So it's a very good idea to add ketoconazole along with cyclosporine when we are treating canine atopic dermatitis. And this is the summary now of clocitinib. If you have, you can use it at the dose rate of 0.4 to 0.6 mg per kg orally and loquivetmap. And we cannot use long-acting steroid. We can use this steroid for a shorter period of time just to stop itching, but not for a longer duration. So this is the thing I have already explained. Why cyclosporine plus ketoconazole? Because ketoconazole increases the absorption of cyclosporine in the bloodstream. So we can reduce the cyclosporine dose just half, 5 mg per kg to 2.5 mg per kg once in a day with ketoconazole. So why not cyclosporine plus terbinafine? Because terbinafine has no effect in the absorption of the cyclosporine, and the mechanism of action of terbinafine is different than the ketoconazole. So there is no effect of terbinafine when we are giving along with cyclosporine. So always you need to use the ketoconazole, because most of the vets are asking that when we use the antifungal drugs, it increases the absorption of cyclosporine. No other antifungal except the ketoconazole. Okay. Now the glucocorticoid. Glucocorticoids, as I think most of the vets, and even this is the favorite drugs of mine also, because it do wonder. And the dose rate of 0.5 to 1 mg per kg prednisolone twice a day, and always taper the dose of glucocorticoid, like every other day, then once in a week like that. And the onset of action is very fast. Okay, it stops pruritus just like an apoquel within 4 to 6 hours. And but there are many side effects like polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, and lethargy, catabolic, glucogenesis, and UTI problem. And sometimes we see when the long term of glucocorticoids are given in the pets, we see the calcinosis cutis. So this is all the advantages when we use the glucocorticoids for long term or long period of time. Now comes the allergen-specific immunotherapy. Allergen-specific immunotherapy, as I have already discussed, that it's not, most very rarely we do in India. I think most of the part of the world, very rare things, because of the cost effective and because of the owner is not, allowing us to do this costly things for allergy. They just want to give the medicine and allergy gone. It's not possible because so many allergic diseases like atopic dermatitis, there are few allergens which causes atopy. So we need to find out those allergens, because otherwise what happened? It is long time disease. We cannot recover this disease by giving just medicine for a shorter period of time. We need to give lifelong treatment for atopy. Okay, so that's why ASIT or allergen specific immunotherapy is very important to resolve this problem. Okay, like what happened in ASIT, it is the administration of the allergen and gradually increasing quantities of an allergen extract to an allergic patient to ameliorate the symptoms associated with the exposure to the causative allergen. And only ASIT will change the pathomechanism of disease by stimulating allergen tolerance. Okay, so it can be given by subcutaneous routes, sublingual and intralymphatic routes. So there are some difference between the two, like subcutaneous route or sublingual route. And in subcutaneous, as the name indicates, we need to inject the allergen into the body of animal. And where in case of sublingual, we need to put the solution, oral solution in the mouth. Okay. And in case of the subcutaneous, sometimes very rarely it produces an adverse reaction. And sometimes in SLIT, dog shows no reactions. It mostly tolerates sublingual immunotherapy. And 65 to 70% of the dog respond with the subcutaneous immunotherapy, while non-responder to subcutaneous immunotherapy often respond to the sublingual immunotherapy. Sublingual even easy also. Owner can do themselves at the home also. It's very easy. Okay, just you need to put the oral solution into the mouth. And injection, the injection are given every 3 to 4 weeks. But in case of the sublingual, drops need to be given once or twice daily. We need to give daily. Okay, so what we can do ultimately for avoidance or for the canine atopic dermatitis, allergen avoidance. And it's very difficult job to avoid the allergen. How can we do that? Like when the dog go out, there are a lot of things, pollens. And if the dog is inside the home, inside or indoor allergens are so many. How we can avoid the carpet, open windows, dust mite, and frequent washing. We need to do all those things to avoid the indoor allergens. And it's practically, it's not possible every day. Okay, that's why it's very difficult to manage the canine atopic dermatitis disease. And in case of the pollen, if the dog is allergic to some pollen, so what we need to do, we need to close the window, avoid outdoor activities, and wipe pets down, bathing frequently. So all these things we need to do, in case of the canine atopic dermatitis. And also, when we talk about the supplementary therapy of canine atopic dermatitis, use of antihistamines and essential fatty acids is also very important when there is a mild pruritus or very less pruritus. Otherwise, there is very less evidence regarding the use of antihistamines in case of the canine atopic dermatitis. And antihistamines are considered that there is no effect or no benefit to treat the acute flare of atopic dermatitis. But I think antihistamines and essential fatty acids are having a benefit when we treat a case for a long term. Okay, so it comes under the long-term therapy of canine atopic dermatitis. We can use it when the pruritus becomes mild. Okay, it will work against the mild pruritus, antihistamines and essential fatty acids. So, and also other than the drugs, we need to also maintain the epidermal dysfunction, epidermal barrier also, because there is a loss of, there is increased transepidermal water loss. When the transepidermal water loss increases, there is a dryness in the skin. So we need to apply some topical humectant or some emollients, emulsifier to reduce the transepidermal water loss. And also for the management of the epidermal barrier function, we need to give sometime the oral supplementation of omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acid, which help to regain the barrier effect. And nowadays, many spot-on are available in the market, like ceramide-containing spot-on, essential spot-ons, and also ceramide-based shampoos. They are very good in restoring epidermal barrier function. So I always use these things along with the drugs, because these are really helpful for treating any canine atopic dermatitis case to resolve this problem, like when we pruritus resolve. But how to prevent the epidermal barrier function? So we can do these things. We can bathe the dog frequently, and we can apply some soothing lotions or some soothing shampoo to the dog. So all these parameters are very important if you are treating canine atopic dermatitis. So this is all supportive therapy. Like, we need to sometimes control the flea and also secondary infection, because along with the canine atopy, sometimes we see the secondary bacterial or malassezia infection. So we need to treat the malassezia and infections along with the canine atopic dermatitis. and frequent bathing with adequate shampoo, very mild irritant shampoo, hypoallergenic shampoo also, and adequate food which contains the high amount of essential fatty acids and which is having limited in those food we need to give in case of the toppy cases. Okay, so this is all we need to do, bathing at least once weekly, or spray and ointment. We can use tacrolimus, one of my favorite, and oral prednisolone or methyl prednisolone. The dose rate is 0.5 to 1 mg per kg just to maintain the pruritus or to stop the pruritus. And when we talk about atopy in case of the cats, which is very difficult to identify atopy in cats. And the atopy in cats is also known by other names like non-flea, non-food hypersensitivity, feline atopy, feline hypersensitivity, feline atopic-like syndrome, feline allergic dermatitis, feline cutaneous hypersensitivity, and feline allergic dermatitis syndrome. So many names are given for atopy in case of the cats. Why atopy is difficult to identify? Atopy is difficult in case of the cats because atopy is not well characterized in cats. The role of IgE is not established. Okay, so just by thorough history or clinical signs, we can able to detect, or excluding all the differential like diagnosis of the exclusion, we come to the conclusion that this cat is suffering from atopy, and we need to do all those things which we need to do for atopy cases. So allergies, they are also allergic to pollens, house dust, and which causes a pruritus, and it's very difficult to diagnose. And atopy is diagnosed, as I have already discussed, that ruling out other potential causes of pruritus, including fleas and other parasites and food. Because fleas are very common in case of the cat. So we need to rule out the fleas when we are diagnosing this atopy in case of the cats. And as I have already discussed, that atopy is incurable and lifelong medication is needed to prevent unacceptable discomfort. Okay, and treatment with essential fatty acids and antibiotic is successful in only a minority of the cases where the secondary infection is there. Then only antibiotic will work. Otherwise, there is no use of antibiotic in CAD. And many cats need the long-term corticosteroid or other immunosuppressive drugs like cyclosporine. In case of cats, we use cyclosporine at the dose rate of 7 mg per kg body weight once in a day. But in case of the cats, we cannot use the Apoquel and Cytopoint, because Cytopoint is specific for the canine. It is a canonized drug. It is not for feline. Okay, so we cannot use Cytopoint in case of the cat. We have two options in case of the cat: corticosteroid and cyclosporine. So this is the picture of the cat. Here you can see this cat is suffering from that atopic dermatitis. And here I have made the table, and I will let you know about this table later. So comes to the food allergy. Food allergy is also one of the important allergic disease which causes severe pruritus, and it is also very difficult to diagnose. And what is food allergy? Basically, it is an abnormal immune mediated reactions to an antigen within the food reactions, within the food reaction caused by the immune system to a specific protein which is found within the food. And how can we differentiate from that topic? It is a non-seasonal disease. Whereas atopy is a seasonal, mostly seasonal, food allergy is a seasonal disease. And here in food allergy, most of the time we see the gastrointestinal disorder also. Okay, 15 to 20% of the cases of food allergic cases, adverse food reactions cases, shows the gastrointestinal sign. And the major complaint is, the main complaint is excessive scratching, which is usually resistant to treatment by steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And sometimes corticosteroid will not work in case of food allergy. So that these two points you need to remember. How can we differentiate food allergy from atopy? That food allergy is a non-seasonal, whereas atopy is a seasonal. And the food allergy is non-responsive against the corticosteroid, while corticosteroid responsive therapy in case of the atopy. Okay, corticosteroid will not work if your case is suffering from adverse food reactions. Okay, now come the clinical sign. According to the clinical sign, we cannot differentiate from each other, like atopy to food allergy, because clinically, almost all the lesions look similar. Okay, so there are some history part, or we can ask few questions from the owner, then only we can differentiate from atopy to food allergy. And one of the gold standard method to diagnose a food reaction is that okay, so here you can see this is the French bulldog showing the sign of perioral erythema, interdigital space erythema, and you can see the feet also, paw also, and the perianal area. And the thing is that here this bulldog was showing a sign of gastrointestinal, means there is a vomitions and loose motions most of the time. Okay, so and there you can, here you can see the secondary pyoderma, and this is the pyoderma which is reoccur every time. So reoccurring pyoderma is here in this patient. And how can we diagnose? This is one of the gold standard method to diagnose the food allergy, is that we need to give diet elimination trial for at least 8 weeks, okay, and followed by a challenge with the previous diet. And if the lesions occur, reoccur, or pruritus occur by following the challenge with the previous diet, it is a confirmed case of adverse food reaction. Okay, so what are the diet which we give in case of the food allergy? So this is, there is some special diet where there is a new protein source. And in homemade diet also, you can have a new protein source diet. You can make it, because most of the time client is not able to give the commercial food. So you can guide the client that you need to give that food your pet has not fed before. Okay, you need to guide these things. So you don't give that food which your pet has taken before. So exclude that protein, you can give anything. You have many options then. Okay, like here also, commercial food based on hydrolyzed protein. There is another option, like one option is novel protein, another option is the hydrolyzed protein. What is hydrolyzed protein? Here the protein where the molecular weight is very high, we can split into small peptides, and which become which the pet can easily digest it and show no allergic sign, okay, by doing hydrolyzation of the protein. And serum or saliva tests are not useful for establishing a diagnosis of food allergy. Like in case of the food allergy, we cannot diagnose it by using allergy testing. Food allergy is not a disease that we can diagnose it by using allergy testing. This is the only method we can diagnose food allergy in case of the pets. Like in cats also. Okay, in cats also the same sign or lesions, but particularly in case of the cat, the target area is the face and ear and neck. Okay, when you see the lesions on the head and face, it can confirm, you can suspect it that it could be the case of the food, adverse food reactions. Okay, and if the dorsal lumbar region is affected, pre-allergy should be suspected. And looking gastrointestinal sign is very helpful in adverse food reaction. We can see the gastrointestinal sign in case of the adverse food reaction in both cat as well as dog. So in case of the cat also, reliable diagnosis we can make it by doing the dietary elimination challenge trial. And we need to give these diet for 8 to 12 weeks to see the results, whether the pruritus is reduced or not. And cats may need to be fed an alternative diet similarly like dog for 6 to 8 weeks to rule out food responsive dermatitis. And the choice of food is very important. Okay, this is not simply switching one brand of cat food for another, because ingredients are quite similar. Okay, when we see the commercial diet, the ingredients, to know about the ingredient is very important, because the diet, the cat, which is allergic against lamb, they may also allergic against the beef also, because the taxonomically they are all same. So the one protein which are allergic to the cat or dog, it is not like that lamb is dog is allergic to lamb, it is not allergic to the beef. It's not like that, because the protein or cross reactivity occurs between the similar type of the protein. Okay, so taxonomic classification is same. Just like if we give the poultry, if cat and dog is allergic against the poultry and chicken, so it's not like that any other poultry you can give the diet to your pet. So if the cat or dog is allergic to the chicken, it may be allergic to some other poultry like kiwi and etc. Okay. So suggest a special hypoallergenic diet for the trial period. And the main point you need to remember, no other food are eaten during the trial period. Okay. If your cats resolve the sign with the food trial and return within 1 week of a food challenge, your cat definitely diagnosed with a food allergy. But the main difficult part is that to convince the owner to give the hypoallergenic food or the food trial for a long period of time, like 8 to 12 weeks. It's very difficult job for the owner at least, because sometimes the dog doesn't like the food and cat doesn't switch over another food. So it's become very frustrating job to provide that food only at a particular period of time. So this is the major disadvantage of food allergy. And sometimes we fail to diagnose the food adverse food reaction in case of dog and cats. So this is the cat. Here you can see the head and face lesions, particularly because of the food reactions. And this is the table I have made where you can differentiate between the atopy and food allergy. So you can see the sign of gastroenteritis in case of the food allergy. There is no sign in case of the atopy. And effect of season is that mostly we see atopy in seasonal, and it's a non-seasonal. Food allergy is a non-seasonal. Effect of steroid is in atopy, instant effect, while in case of the food allergy, not effective. And effect of food elimination trial in case of the atopy, there is no effect, while in case of the food allergy, it reduces, the sign reduces within 6 to 8 weeks. Now comes the sarcoptic mange. It is one of the most important parasitic diseases in which the dog scratch like anything, even in the examination room. It is so much parasitic. Okay, it is very common in dogs, highly contagious, and it is having a zoonotic importance. And owner also sometimes present with the mild parasitic lesions, and it is spread by direct contact between the dogs, indirect contact through the crust and fomites, MTKJ. And it causes severe pruritus. Like the scale of pruritus is 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10 sometimes. Okay. And it is very poorly or non-responsive to the glucocorticoid. Remember, it will not respond to the glucocorticoid. If the sarcoptic mange is there, it will not respond against the glucocorticoid. Just it helps to stop the pruritus, but the case will not recover if you have not diagnosed the sarcoptic mange by doing the diagnostic workup. And here in sarcoptis, we see generally the erythema, papule, alopecia, excoriation, crust, lichenification, and sometimes self-induced alopecia. In the chronic cases, lymphadenopathy and weight loss also we see. And clinical sign is this, the acute onset of pruritus, very instant pruritus is there. It shows the positive pinnal, scratch reflex, papule scaling, and yellowish crust are the usual early signs. Here we see generally the yellowish crust in case of the scabies. And the predilection site is mostly scabies is in the margin of the ear pinna and also on the elbow and hock, ventral chest, ventral abdomen, and focal and multifocal sometimes generalized. And in chronic cases, we see excoriation, lichenification, and hyperpigmentation. So this is the distribution of the lesion. You can see here, this is in this dog, you can see there's a margin of the ear is involved, particularly in case of the scabies or sarcoptic mite. And here the elbow and the hock joint is involved in case of scabies. And sometimes we see on the groin area also, papulocrustus lesions we see in case of the dog suffering from sarcoptic mange. So there is a papular eruption, erythema, scaling, and excoriation. So here, this is a case of mine. Here you can see a very typical sign symptom. You can see here the margin of the ear become crusty or yellow crust. You can see very clearly in the margin, in the ear margin. And here also you can see the periocular alopecia in this dog. Both the ear, you can see there is a crusty lesions in the ear margin. And this is also the another case of dog which is having a scabies. And this is very interesting case. Here you can see the typical lesions on the elbow joint. Here you can see the petechial papular crust is there. And when we did the microscopic examination, we find a lot of eggs of Sarcoptes. And only one egg, when we find the one egg or one Sarcoptes, it is very diagnostic. And here you can see a lot of eggs. That means this case is having a lot of adult mites. Then only there is a possibility of having a lot of eggs. And this is the hand of owner who is having the same lesions, papular eruptions on the skin of on the skin. Here you can see the joint elbow of owner. So the same lesions occur in the dog and in the pet owner. So it's very zoonotic. It's very zoonotic. You need to take a lot of care if your dog is suffering from the zoonotic, this type of infection. So it's very pruritic. Even in case of the human, also it's very pruritic. So diagnosis is easy on the basis of history and clinical picture. And pruritus is a very important sign in Sarcoptes because animal do scratching or biting or chewing himself even in the examination room in the clinic. And how we do diagnosis? By doing the superficial skin scraping, multiple superficial skin scraping we need to do, particularly from the ear margin, elbow, hock and ventral abdomen. And we need to collect the crust from multiple sites over from the large area of the body. And this point is very important, that pinnal pedal reflex. It is mostly 90% of the cases we see the positive pinnal pedal reflex. What we do in pinnal pedal reflex, to check the pinnal pedal reflex, we rub the tip of the ear flap, particularly at the base, vigorously for 5 seconds. If the dog is having a scabies or Sarcoptes, dog makes a scratching movement with the hind leg. So it is considered positive for scabies. 90 to 92% cases are showing the positive pinnal pedal reflex. And sometimes we are not able to find Sarcoptes, but we have a doubt that that case is suffering from scabies. So there is no problem to use this therapeutic trial drug like isoxazoline, which for example, fluralenar or silamectin in those cases.
Hartwood Pharma introduces Endrohard 10 Serum, Endrofloxacin 10 mg per 5 ml, Fluoroquinolone antibiotic systemic drug. Now, easiest way to administer Endrofloxacin in small breeds or exotic animals. Yes, Endrofloxacin in syrup form, Endrohard 10 Serum. Endrofloxacin oral solution 10 mg per 5 ml. Uses and indications. Use in dogs and cats for the management of bacterial infections susceptible to Endrofloxacin. Lower urinary tract infections, enteric infections, bacterial skin infections. Dosage for dogs 5 to 20 mg per kg per day every 24 hours for at least 2 to 3 days. Cats, 5 mg per kg every 24 hours. Route, oral. Presentation, 60 ml. You can book your order online at www.hartwood.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So here in this, you can see I am examining that, I have examined that case and we found a lot of Sarcoptes. Here you can see only one Sarcoptes, but in this slide a number of Sarcoptes mite is present and crawling like anything, and so many eggs were there. And you can see, and you can show these things to the client also, this video, so that your client become have awareness, because this is a zoonotic kind of problem. So you need to show these slides to the client to take care, and you need to refer the client also to show themselves to the human dermatologist, because this is a zoonotic problem. So this is again the Sarcoptes And now here also you can see a lot of Sarcoptes, and these are the eggs of Sarcoptes mites. So now comes to the treatment. Treatment part is very easy when you diagnose any case, because we have a lot of new things are available in the market now. We can particularly use silamectin in case of scabies, Sarcoptes revolution. This is a spot on, and it is also very safe in coolies and their crosses also. And it Sarcoptes cases needs 2 to 3 applications. What I generally do every 15 days or once in a month, you can repeat it for 3 treatment, and all the mites and eggs go away. Okay, so also in contact dogs also need to be treated, because this is a contagious or contagious kind of problem. So you need to treat, if the owner is having 3 or 4 dogs at a home, then you need to treat all the dogs, because it's a contagious infection, or it can occur in all the dogs or animals in the household. So environmental treatment is also very important with an acaricidal product, because it's a very contagious, and here and there so many things are able to again cause the infection in case of the dogs. So we need to treat the environment also with the help of the acaricidal product. And also there are some another option, moxidectin, imidacloprid. This is also we can use 2 to 3 applications. The dose rate is 2.5 to 5 mg per kg monthly. And my favorite is Flural NR, which is Brevecto, 25 mg per kg. You can use every 3 months. It is quite effective against all the ectoparasites. And ivermectin also, you can use it at the dose rate of 300 mcg microgram per kg subcutaneous for 2 to 3 treatment, 2 weeks apart. Means every 15 days you need to give the injectable for 3 treatments. And if you want to give oral tablets, then you need to give the 300 microgram per kg orally for 4 to 6 treatments weekly. Okay, weekly you need to give tablets. And if you want to give the injectable, then 2 weeks apart you need to give the injectable form in case of scabies. And other option is Amitraz. And in this also you can use Amitraz for bathing, and also the lime sulfur dip. But Amitraz, I am not a big fan of Amitraz, because after doing Amitraz solution, the dog skin become very dry, and there are some other side effects of Amitraz. So I am not a big fan of Amitraz. I am not using very frequently Amitraz in my clinic. And lime sulfur dips also we can use it, particularly in case of the cats. It's quite useful, but the major disadvantage is that the white cat become yellow because of staining. And so I also don't want to use this lime sulfur also in most of the cases, but sometimes I need to use it. And fipronil spray is also very good spray for if you want to treat the young puppies. So fipronil spray is quite effective in young puppies. And if necessary, prescribe the prednisolone or ochlocetinib to control the pruritus, but for a short period of time. Just to stop the itching, you can give prednisolone or ochlocetinib to avoid pruritus. So this is the classical human scabies. You can see if the owner is also suffering from scabies. Now comes the notodrescati, which is a mange in case of the cat. And the cat shows the similar lesions, just like a dog. The crust formation, hyperkeratosis, particularly in the ear margin, face, crusty face. Okay, so notoidrescati also very zoonotic. Owner also is having an intense pruritus over the hand, erythematous papule. Here you can see the this picture where the crusty lesions is present on the face and ear of the cat. And here you can see this video of the cat. This is the case of mine, where a lot of owner is having stray cats who has adopted these cats. And there, here you can see the crusty lesions on the face and ear margin. So this cat was on ivermectin tablet. And this is the post-recovery pic. Here you can see now the cat looks so beautiful after giving the Neomac tablet at the dose rate of 300 microgram per kg every week. Okay, oral tablets. So this is the notoidrescati, which we see very frequently in case of the cat. And in case of the cat, silamectin is a very appropriate spot on. We can use it without any side effects. And Brevecto spot on also we can use in case of the cat. It is very, very effective because but unfortunately Brevactor spot-on is not available in India, but I think very soon it will come. And now comes the flea allergy dermatitis. In flea allergy dermatitis, this is also the second most important diseases which causes intense pruritus after Sarcoptes. Okay, Sarcoptes causes pruritus, intense pruritus, and after Sarcoptes, this is the problem in which pruritus is very intense, even in the examination room. The dog scratch like anything. Okay, so here we see there is so much scratch or itching is there. The animal remove large patches of their own skin due to the chewing or biting on their own skin. Okay, so common areas affected, I have already discussed that flea allergy affects where the lesions are mostly found on the lumbosacral area and the caudal part of the thigh and the base of the tail. It is a common site for the fleas. So severe pruritus of the lumbosacral area and the caudal part of the body. And here we see the erythema, papule, crusted papule, secondary alopecia, excoriation, and sometimes the acute moist dermatitis, which we commonly say the hot spot. Okay, so hot spot, one of the major reason for hot spot is flea allergy dermatitis. Okay. So distribution of the host, when we talk about the distribution lesions, in case of the cat, the predilection site is head and neck along with lumbosacral area, while in case of the dog, along with lumbosacral area, the predilection site is sometimes we see in the stomach and the hind quarter. So here you can see the distribution of skin lesions in this picture. Pruritus associated with the CAD, canine atopic flea allergy dermatitis. And here you see the lesions, particularly on the lumbosacral area and on the on the groin area. So this is my case where this dog is suffering from flea allergy dermatitis. And here you can see the extensive lesion from back to dorsal or the dorsum of the this case of Labrador suffering from flea allergy dermatitis. And it was so pruritic. And this is another case. You can see the hot spot at the base of the tail because of the flea allergy. And this is the typical lesions in case of the dog. You can see here the crusted papule lesions on the lumbosacral area. And so that you can easily diagnose the flea allergy dermatitis by seeing the lesions. And also, if you want to confirm your diagnosis, then what we can do, we need to just use the flea comb. Like I will let you know after. This, like here, you can see the cat. The cat is also suffering from the flea allergy. Owner came for the medical therapy as well as the medical bathing for flea allergy. And here we can diagnose it by using microscopic examination. Flea also laying the egg. Here you can see the flea laid the egg. Here this is a flea egg, and here you can see this is a flea feces. This is the particular red or brown tinge color you can see under the microscope. This is the flea feces and this is the flea egg. So sometimes owner need to understand the life cycle of flea because it is very, very crucial for the extermination to be successful therapy of flea allergy dermatitis, because we need to tell the client that it's not like that one injection will cure your case. It's not like that. We need to you need to visit for after 15 days or at a particular period of time. So you need to tell the protocol what we need to do generally in flea allergy dermatitis. So when you tell the owner, when you educate the owner regarding the flea life cycle, then only owner come to know about what's going on, because flea is just not a flea. There is a process, like adult flea lay up to 50 eggs a day. And these eggs hatch on animals or even in the environment. And after that, larva hatch out. Okay. And larva hatch out. This larva is a negatively phototactic. It is having a fear of sunlight. That's why this larva is found move towards move under the chair or under the carpet, inside the home, and outside the home, these larva is found on the shaded area, under the shaded area. So whenever and after the larva, what happened, this pupa, this is the pupa stage, it form and it can survive up to 300 days time. So pupa is a stage which is quite resistant against any acaricidal drug or spray. It will not, the spray will not work against pupa. That's why we need to tell all the whole life cycle to the client. You need to come after 15 days. We will do again the spot on, then again spot on. So you need to have 3 to 4 treatment for flea allergy dermatitis. Then only we can kill the adult form, egg form, larva form. And when the pupa become again adult, then only we can kill the adult flea. Otherwise, pupa stage, we cannot kill it because there is a cocoon formation and there is a resistant form of pupa. So this is the resistant form. Okay, that's why we need to tell all the story about flea to the client. Very complex. Now, a test for flea feces is very important sometimes when owner do not recognize the presence of the flea and the flea feces on the body of their pet. And sometimes they don't agree with you that there is a presence of the fleas. They say, or they always say that, no, my cat and dog is not suffering from any fleas. There is no ticks and fleas. So you need to do this test while using the flea comb, and you need to put the animal on the paper, and you need to put some water. If there is a presence of the flea, it becomes the brown tinged appearance or red in color. So you can show the client there is a presence of the fleas or flea feces, then only the owner or client convince about the treatment plan. Okay, so dermatology is not very easy. It's a very difficult job to convince the owner about the treatment it is only possible when you diagnose the case, when you are able to diagnose the case. You cannot make a treatment plan straightforward without diagnosing and without doing the diagnostic workup. That's why I am focusing more on the diagnostic plan again and again. So for the treatment of flea allergy, I don't find ivermectin effective against the flea allergy because it is an acaricidal drug. It's not an insecticidal. Okay, so but silymectin is having a very good response against the flea allergy dermatitis. We need to give the 3 to 4 treatment 2 to 3 weeks apart. Okay, every once in 15 days, we need to give the silymectin spot on. And also moxidectin spot on we can use for flea allergy. And and also, it's not easy to control flea from the body of the animal. It is also very important to control the flea from the environment, because it's not a body where flea is found more frequently. It is the environment where the 75% fleas are present. Okay, so we need to control the environment by using some sprays to control the flea. And also, if inside the home, we need to use the vacuum cleaner, we need to wash the carpet, we need to use some steaming washing of the carpet and the sofa. We need to sterilize everything for flea control. Okay, so Flura-Lenar is quite effective for at least 90 days. It is one of the important thing. We can control the flea for 3 months. It kills fleas within 8 hours. That's why it's quite effective, Brevecto. And topical adulticides like Fipronil, Imidacloprid and Silymectin having good to excellent results. And in case of the flea allergy also, we can use the prednisolone for a short period of time, not for a long time, because for a short period of time, just to avoid the pruritus and just to stop the pruritus, because flea allergy is very, you know, the animal become very pathetic while doing scratching and chewing all the time. Okay, so that's why it's very important. So this is the human leg where flea can bite even in case of the human. That's why it's a zoonotic importance also in case of the flea allergy. Basically, this allergy is basically because in the saliva of the flea, there is some histamine like material is present. When the flea bite to the animal or to the human, the animal or human become allergic. So sometimes there is a type 1 type of hypersensitivity, and sometimes we see the delayed type of hypersensitivity. When the flea saliva contain the haptin, it combined with the skin collagen, and it becomes purely complete antigen after complete protein. Then only it becomes, after that it becomes, animal become allergic to the flea saliva. So it's all, we need to understand why the animal is allergic to flea, why the human is allergic to flea, what are the zoonoses. So all those things is very important in case of the pruritus, because the first question comes to the owner's mind is that, is this disease communicable? So we need to be very careful while telling all those things to the client or owner. So I will move fast in demodicosis, because demodicosis is the disease pruritus is very rare. And almost no pruritus we see in case of the dog. But yes, in case of the cat, here very fast I'll let you know that demodicosis, in case of the dog, there are three species, Canis, Inzai, and Corni. And there are two types, localized and generalized. And this disease I have already discussed in my previous webinar. I think you all know about the demodicosis. And pruritus is almost absent in demodicosis. And this is the case of boxer. Here you can see the erythematous lesions on the perioral area. And when we did the microscopic examination, we found a lot of demodex. Okay, so this is why important, because why I am showing this, because in this the pruritus was there, particularly on the facial region. That's why most of us, we can confuse it with the atopic dermatitis, but never confuse. We always need to do the microscopic examination to rule out the things. And this is again the Pomeranian case of focal demodicosis. Here, this is the area only affected on the face, and the owner was a little frustrated. What's going on the face of my dog? So we need to, again, a microscopic examination we need to do. And on the microscopic examination, we found the demodex. Okay, so it's a localized form of the demodicosis. So pododemodicosis, I have already discussed in my pododermatitis cases and lecture. And oral demodicosis also I have covered in my chronic otitis. And generalized demodicosis, when we talk about the generalized demodicosis, means when the lesions are where the lesions we found more than five distinct body regions. Okay, more than five body regions are affected in case of the generalized demodicosis. And these are the lesions we find in the generalized demodicosis: scaling, ulceration, comedon, follicular cast, pustular demodicosis, and hemorrhagic bullae. Okay, so all those things we see in demodicosis. Here, this is the case of Beagle. It came to my clinic with the frustrated client that my pet is not recovering. I am using the treatment and I am showing this pet so many places, and I have given all treatment according to the doctor, but my pet is not showing any recovery. So by physical examination or by visual perception, you can imagine or you can suspect that it could be demodicosis. It's a typical sign you can see here: facial erythematous scaling, petechial hemorrhages you can see here. And 15 days after treatment, when I did the examination, and the case was like this. After 15 days only, I have used a simple single tablet because the owner themselves was very frustrated. I have given so many tablets, so many antibiotics, everything I have given. I don't want to do anything. So what I have done, I did the microscopic examination. When I have shown the owner what's going on under the microscope, they are able to see a lot of Demodex were crawling under the microscope on the slide. So owner was very happy to see finally their pet is diagnosed with the Demodex. Okay, so when we gave the treatment for Demodex brevecto, this is the patient after 15 days just, and the owner was so happy after that. So finally, owner came with a happy face, and also the pet got so much relief after treatment. Okay, so sometimes we need to do the examination, proper examination. Just don't do any treatment without examination, because the case, the simple case, become more and more complicated if we miss diagnostic part. So this is again the small puppy. You see the lesions, crusty lesions, and it's a juvenile demodicosis, and all over the body or generalized demodicosis was there. So in such a small puppy, we cannot do anything. Just we can do the topical therapy or immune. We can give the immune boosters, and somehow we can. We need to treat this case, which is suffering from the demodicosis. Here also, this is a small puppy who is suffering from the demodicosis. And this is again the pit bull. You can see the generalized demodicosis, and you can see how painful it's looking. Erythematous, inflamed lesions all over the body. Here again, you can see the lesions on the face because of the demodicosis. And this is again another case, German Shepherd having perioral lesions, crusty lesions. You can see this is all demodicosis. And this is again, it was a very interesting case. You can see the Labrador look like a Rottweiler here. You can see the puffy face. And basically this case was suffering from the thyroid, also hypothyroid. Along with the hypothyroid, there was a demodicosis. And now this case look better and doing good nowadays. And this is again the case of demodicosis. And this is the demodicosis. After treatment, after 10 or 15 days, it looks like this. If you get the basically treatment part is very easy. I have already giving this my point of view, that treatment is always easy when you diagnose the case. So always focus on the diagnostic part. Always do microscopic examination, whether you understand the case or not. Always show the client what's going on the skin of the dog. Then the owner or client, your client become convinced after seeing what's going on. Otherwise, you will not crack any case, and your pet owners will not follow your advice, whatever you give, if you are not to give the diagnosis. Okay, so diagnosis is very easy. I think demodicosis is the disease. We can easily, everyone can able to find out, but we need to do the diagnostics. And you can see the eggs, larva, and the presence of more than two larva in a field indicates actively progressive disease. And adults are cigar shaped, four pair of leg is there, eight legged was is there, and presence of maximum of one single adult mite in consecutive five field has no relevance, and larva in every field is highly significant. So this is the Demodex. And treatment part is, again, there are so many options now available in the market. And you can use the brevecto, you can use efoxolanor or NexGard is easily available in Indian market also. And there are so many options to treat Demodex cases. And Amitraz is also having a good results in demodicosis cases. But dogs do not use Amitraz 12 weeks below age dog. And it is contraindicated in the Chihuahua breed. And always clip medium to long hair dogs. Solution should penetrate the skin and the hair follicles. Then only it works against the demodicosis. Okay, so this is all. And this is the another case of my Chow Chow breed. Here you can see the lesions, hyperpigmented lesions, because the case becomes so chronic. And now the case becomes so beautiful after giving treatment. And I have given just a Floral and R Brevecto tablet to this dog. And the recovery was very good. So again, moxidroxin spot on we can use. Ivermectin tablet is very good in case of the Timodex also at the dose rate of 300 to 600 microgram per kg per day. Orally, even you can give this ivermectin up to 210 days. No worry about that how many days we need to give, like 6 days, 7 days. No, until you find negative skin scraping. You need to give till then. Sorry. Clinical cure varied between 83 to 100%. And it is contraindicated, but it is contraindicated in coolies and their process. And when we talk about the demodicosis in case of the cats, it is caused by the Demodex cati and gutti. And cati is again similar to the Demodex canis. It looks very similar. And gutti is very important in case of the cat because it causes over-grooming in case of the cats. And it's because it is a superficial mite, it is found on the stratum corneum, and the cat overgroom all the time, and there we find a lot of hair loss on both the side of the body of the cat. And here this is the Demodex gutti. Here you can see the small blunt mite. This is the Demodex gutti in case of cat. And diagnosis is by doing the skin scraping, superficial scraping. But most of the time, the diagnosis of Demodex gutti is very challenging because of the habit of over-grooming. They sometimes ingest the Demodex gutti, and sometimes we need to do the fecal flotation technique to find out the Demodex gutti. And the treatment part is again easy. We can use the Brevecto spot on, not the Brevecto tablet. We need to do the Brevecto spot on, or also we can use the silomectin and lime sulfur dip and oral ivermectin. If we have no option, then oral ivermectin we can use in case of the cat for Demodex. And don't worry, Demodex does not cause any zoonotic importance. They do not cause zoonosis. And now comes the Calicheella. It's a walking dandruff. It also causes sometimes pruritus, and it is found on the dorsum of the body of a dog, like scales, lot of scales when you see the dorsum. And Calicheella yasgurai is in dogs, and Calicheella blacky in case of the cats. And basically it feeds on the keratinocytes. That's why you see a lot of scales on the dorsum sometimes. And we can diagnose it by using the skin scraping, coat brushing, and hair plucking. It's a small puppy here. You can see the lot of scales on the dorsum of the body, and we find the Calicheella mite sometime. It's not, it looks like just a dandruff, but it's not a dandruff, it's a walking dandruff. So we need to find out under the microscope what's going on. It's just a dandruff or it's a walking dandruff. And the treatment part is easy. Again, ivermectin, silomectin, and even fipronil spray you can use weekly for 4 weeks. We need to treat all in contact animals, and environment should be clean, treated with an environmental acaricide. Otodactis infestation is important in case of the cat. It's very common in case of kitten. We see more frequently, and physically we see the dry blackish brown granules and erythema and excoriation in the ear of the kitten. And this is the kitten. You can see the brown color, and this is another kitten. You can see the dry coffee color wax inside the ear canal. And diagnosis is easy. We just do the skin scraping, and we find this Otodactis mite. This is the under the microscope we can see how Otodactis is crawling. And here this is the video otoscope examination of the ear canal. Here you can see a lot of mites crawling inside the ear. So you need to show the client all those things. Now, secondary causes of the pruritus. It is, I have already discussed, these are also the things which causes the pruritus, but not so severe as I have discussed in big four cause of pruritus, like atopy, food allergy, sarcoptis, and flea allergy. So pyoderma, bacterial overgrowth, dry skin, and malassezia, which causes pruritus, but there is a mild or moderate itching. So malassezia pachydermatitis, it's very easy to identify. I have already discussed all those malassezia sign in my previous webinar. There is a greasy appearance, bad odor due to the sebum rancidity, and this is the distribution we see mostly in case of the malassezia. Like here, you can see the periural, periocular, feet, and groin area, axilla. So this is the case of malassezia. Here you can see how badly affected it with the yeast or fungal infection. Here you can see the very clearly that the skin of the Labrador become the elephant like. So this is the elephant skin in case of the Malassezia dermatitis. And this is the case of Malassezia. Here you can see how bad this pug is having Malassezia infection. And basically this dog was suffering from the atopy. And because of the chronic form of the atopy, the case become more complicated because of the not diagnosis on time and untreated. And this is after a week when I have seen the case and found a lot of Malassezia. I have treated the case for Malassezia. And diagnosis, when you see the yeast or peanut-shaped yeast, more than 10 organisms, it is considered significant. And this is the method how we do basically the diagnosis. We need to use this bud under the fold or just smear it on the slide and stain it. You can find a lot of Malassezia peanut-shaped structure under the microscope. And the treatment is very easy when you find the Malassezia. Like you can do the shampooing with containing the 2% ketoconazole, miconazole, and chlorhexidine. And 10-minute contact time should be there. Ointment or lotion you can use for fungal infections. And even for Malassezia, you can use itraconazole, fluconazole, terbinafine, and with food and duration minimum 3 weeks. So for long-term or maintenance, bathing with the adequate shampoo, we need to use 1 to 2 times weekly. It is quite effective. Pyoderma also, we can see the secondary infection in most of the diseases. So there are some underlying conditions going on like allergies, flea or mite infestation, chin acne. Most of the time in case of the cat, we see chin acne. It is all pyoderma because of the underlying condition. And and any diseases that causes itching and self-trauma can trigger a pyoderma. Like if a dog is having a habit of swimming, or a lot of swimming is swimming, when the dog do a lot of swimming, then because of the retention of the moisture for a long period of time, the skin become more prone to the secondary infections, like for pyoderma or for Malassezia. So there are 3 types of pyoderma: surface, superficial, and deep. Under surface, acute moist dermatitis, skin fold pyoderma, and microbial overgrowth. Superficial include impetigo, folliculitis, superficial spreading pyoderma, mucocutaneous pyoderma, and deep localized folliculitis and bacterial granuloma. Hotspot, we all know this is the moist dermatitis or pyotraumatic dermatitis we see because of the pre-allergy dermatitis sometimes, and sometimes because of the retention of the moisture or improper drying of the body of the skin of the dog. Sometimes because of the retention of the moisture, it become there become a hot spot or moist dermatitis. This is here you can see the hot spot because of the allergy, pre-allergy, and the sign are same, the severe pruritus, erythema, and in case of the bacterial dermatitis, this sign, epidermal collarette, is very important in case of the pyoderma. So when you see the epidermal collarette, we can easily differentiate with the fungal infection or dermatophyte. Okay, so this is the pyoderma in case of the dog. You can see this is all pyoderma images. And in case of the cat, you see the chin acne. Okay, diagnosis is easy. By doing the smear examination, you will find a lot of cocci or rods, whatever, under the microscope. And treatment, you do the topical as well as the systemic antibiotic as per the condition or as per the severity of the case. Bacterial overgrowth is why bacterial overgrowth, to understand bacterial overgrowth is important, because bacterial overgrowth is bacterial overgrowth looks like atopy, and we need to rule out whether it is a bacterial overgrowth or atopy. I'll show you the images. How can we differentiate? Like for bacterial overgrowth, Staphylococcus pseudo intermedius is involved. So here, this is the pug, just 4 months of age, 4 months age, and here we see the same lesion, same sign as we see in case of the atopy. But in 3 or 4 months old puppy, we generally, I have already discussed that the atopy we see particularly, typically 6 months, 3 years of age. But these signs we see under 6 months, like this is just a 3 or 4 month old puppy, we see these signs. So when we do this examination or under microscopic examination, we found the cocci on the corneocytes, and clinical signs you can see basically what happened in BOG also. There is no papule, pustule, epidermal collarette, just there is an erythema. and just there is erythema. Basically, this is all because of the moisture retention. It affects the cutaneous microbial population and the erythema occur. And particularly, this occur on the axillary and inguinal region. And this condition may occur also in any other body part also. So it can be confused with the atopic dermatitis. So always try to rule out before going straight forward, before jumping to the conclusion. Okay, we need to examine the case while doing the cytology. We find the cocci. So it's become clear that this case is suffering from the bacterial overgrowth, not atopic dermatitis. So this is the cytology, and the treatment is antibiotic. We need to give for 3 weeks or according to the case presentation. We need to do the topical application and topical therapy. Dermatophytosis is very important in case of the cats. It's not so pruritic in case of the dog, but it is very pruritic in case of the cat. And it is caused by the Microsporum canis in case of the cat. Cat become infected. Basically, it's also a very zoonotic disease and very contagious. It can, cat become infected by coming into contact with any infected animal or the infected environment. And dermatophytosis can be seen in any age group of the cat. And it's very, there is a pruritus, variable pruritus. But in case of the cat, we see the pruritus. And how can we define it? Because the owner sometimes not give a proper history of pruritus. So we need to do the microscopic examination. There we find the broken or frayed hair under the microscope. And particularly in case of the Persian cat, we see dermatophytosis most commonly. So diagnosis is easy just by doing the microscopic examination, and also by doing the wood slamp examination, we see the lesions. And one of the clue factor is that the zoonosis is there. In dermatophytosis, the same erythematous or circular lesions are present on the human also, and this is my case where cat there, this owner is having 8 or 10 cats, the same lesions is present on their own skin. So we come to the conclusion that it could be suffering from dermatophytosis or Microsporum canis. Here I have done the wood slamp examination for the Microsporum canis examination. Now the treatment part, again the same for like Malassezia. Yeah, we need to give the itraconazole. Is only authorized treatment for feline dermatophytosis. We need to treat in contact animal also and decontaminate the environment. Now I will move very fast for the case presentation. This was the case one, the Oreo 3 months old beagle. Owner was observed some crusty red areas on the abdomen, and there was a severe scratching and licking of the abdomen and legs and feet. Previous vet suspected food allergy and prescribed a novel protein diet. Even after 4 weeks of food trial, no recovery. And even though Oreo was still very itchy and the lesions were spreading to all over the ventral part and legs. On revisit, vet suspected an allergy and administered a corticosteroid injection, according to owner, which gave her only 2 to 3 days of relief. So what is your opinion? What are you thinking? So you can see 3 point is very important, that it is very pruritic. And the lesions you can see on the abdomen, legs, and feet. Okay, so maybe again owner come to the derma center for second opinion, and he told me about one thing very clearly, that along with his pet, all the 4 member of the family were also affected. So there is a zoonosis. So one thing click in your mind, you can suspect one thing, what it could be. Here you can see, this is the 40-second video of a 3-month-old beagle. Here you can see how madly he is scratching his hind feet. Continuous itching is there. It's quite itchy. He is chewing himself. Okay. So you can see how scratchy or how itchy skin is that. And now this is the clinical picture. You can see here how is the crusty lesions on the elbow and spreading. Here also in the ventral abdomen and the elbow. I think you can now guess it, what it could be. So here, this is the skin of owner. All the owners have got the papular eruption on their skin. And the diagnosis was done by doing the skin scraping. I have taken the sample from the crusted area, papules and elbow. And also I did the tape stripping. And I found this mite. again Sarcoptes mite and the egg. So this is a confirmed case of the scabies. So I have done the silomactin spot on, and I have given the prednisolone just to control the pruritus because the dog is so pruritic. Case number two is also very interesting. It's a pug, 3 year year male intact, came with a complaint of severe itching and fall odor. On physical examination, I found the erythematosotitis and perioral erythema. You can see the clinical picture, how erythematous lesions here. You can see here perioral and in the ear. So on cytology, I found a lot of malassezia. So in this case, if you miss the diagnostic workup, you just you have a guess that it could be atopy or food allergy. Okay, because clinical signs looks like a food allergy or atopy, but it's not a food allergy or it's not atopy because there was no previous history of atopy or food allergy. And I have just treated for the malassezia. Here you can see a lot of malassezia under cytology. And I have just treated for the malassezia, giving antifungal drugs, and I have not given anything. And even after 2 months of therapy, the lesions not relapse. That means there is a malassezia overgrowth only. There was this is not the case of the atopy or food reactions, adverse food reactions. So after recovery, you can see the all the erythema and inflammation gone. Last case is the case number three. This is the Pluto, German golden retriever. Owner came with a complaint of intense chewing of the back and tail chasing. And there was a papule crust over the lumbosacral region and at the base of the tail. Here you can see how bad, here you can see this is the papule, crusty papule on the lumbosacral area. So on the basis of the history and clinical sign and observation of the flea and flea feces, we have diagnosed it that this is a case of the flea bite allergy. And we have diagnosed by placing the flea feces on the moistened white paper where you can see the red brown tinged here. And also we found a lot of fleas on the body of the animal. So it's a very easy method. We can easily detect it, flea allergy dermatitis, and convince the owner for the further treatment plan. So treatment part is easy, spot on Bravecto. And to check the pruritus, we can give the corticosteroid. So thank you everyone. My takeaway message is that to treat cases of itch and pruritus, not only appropriate clinical approach is required, but a cordial relation with the pet owner is also needed. So that exhaustive diagnostic workup, timely visits, and client adherence to the recommended treatment plan may be successfully established. Thank you everyone. Thank you for listening.
Hadvit Pharma Private Limited is a pharmaceutical company with its head office at Meerut. It was founded on 29 January 2019 with a vision to provide affordable and quality veterinary medicine to our pet parents. Hadvit Pharma is doing marketing of veterinary pharmaceuticals throughout India. In a small span of 1 year, we have launched 51 products in the veterinary pharma industry to serve our clients. In future 1 year, we are planning to have a product basket of more than 100 products. Hadvit is different from other veterinary pharma companies as we don't have distribution channel. We understand the latest needs of market, and for this reason we have adapted to online module of selling our drugs to field practitioners. We are serving our clients by providing the required medicines at their doorstep without any middleman. We directly collect orders online, mobile app, WhatsApp, telephonic from our end customers, and we deliver the required products to their doorstep through our nationwide logistic partners Blue Dart, DTDC, TCI Express. We are happy to announce that in our client list, most of the leading pet practitioners of India are included. To assure the unbreakable faith of our clients in our company products, we look after the quality of products, starting from selecting the raw material for our final products, aseptic precautions during manufacturing, and proper storage of finished products till supply to the end customers to ensure quality of products. We are happy to share that Hadvit Pharma has been recognized at various business platforms. Recently, an article on Hadvit Pharma has been published in the leading business magazine, Business Connect. One more milestone in the success story for Hadvit Pharma is that the managing director of the company, Dr. Rajneesh Tyagi, has been awarded Young Asian Entrepreneurs Award at Bangkok, Thailand on 7 February 2020. Our vision states Hatfield Pharma to be a commercially viable leading veterinary pharmaceutical company in providing quality products affordable to various sections of the pet owner society. Our endeavor is to be a front runner in innovation and quality in the veterinary pharma industry. We see a very bright future for our company as we are working in pet industry, which itself is growing at a higher rate, approximate growth of 20% annually. We are regularly working on the knowing of needs of our customers to serve them in a better way. We value your support to Hatfield Pharma and are very thankful to all of you. We look forward for a very strong and long business association between veterinarians and Hatfield Pharma. Thank you.